Hello and welcome to the TI Precision Labs for Motor Drives on discussing sensored versus sensorless control of BLDC motors. In this video, we will discuss the purpose of both sensored and sensorless control. What is sensored control? What is sensorless control? And compare both control methods. Let's begin with the purpose of both sensored control and sensorless control. When driving a brushless DC motor, the system needs to execute motor commutation, which is when the motor moves from one position to the next. To do this, you must know where the rotor position is relative to the stator so that you can apply a magnetic field that forces the rotor to move in the desired direction. Sensored control implies that you are using physical sensors on the motor to determine the exact position of the rotor. Sensorless control means that you are using other methods to estimate the rotor position without any physical sensors. What is sensored control? Sensors are used to determine the actual location of the rotor relative to the stator. While there are many different types of these position sensors, the most common are resolvers, encoders, and Hall effect sensors. These all fundamentally do the same thing, which is to give a signal which is an indicator of when to commutate the motor. The resolver is a sensor that uses induced current to output an analog voltage with respect to the rotor position. In this graph, you see this as the sine and cosine output of the resolver. These two signals will tell you the angular position of the rotor to a high degree of accuracy. This signal needs to be processed by an MCU to determine where and when to commutate. The encoder is either an optical or electromechanical device that is attached to the motor shaft. The encoder will output a pattern of zeros and ones with respect to the rotor position. Some encoders will output 256 or more pulses when the motor makes one mechanical revolution. A microcontroller can count these pulses to determine where the rotor is and when to commutate the motor. The Hall effect sensors are devices that use the Hall effect to determine the rotor's magnetic field and output either a 1 or a 0. Three Hall effect sensors are used to determine which of the six commutation states the motor driver needs to be in. To compare these three sensored control devices, resolvers give you a high resolution on where the rotor is, allowing for very accurate position sensing applications. Encoders can also allow a higher resolution than Hall effect sensors can, but lower resolution than resolvers. Hall sensors give you a low resolution on where the rotor is, but are more simple and lower cost to implement. It is important to note that resolvers or encoders require precise coupling to the motor shaft, while Hall effect sensors need to be placed inside the physical construction of the motor. What is sensorless control? This control scheme uses no position sensors, so it must estimate the rotor position in relation to the stator by using parameters such as winding resistance or back EMF to determine where or when to commutate the motor. What is back EMF? Back EMF is a pseudonym for back electromotive force, or referred to as the acronym BEMF. Back EMF is the voltage induced on a wire when a changing magnetic field is applied. To find out where this voltage comes from and what affects it, we will look at Faraday's law. Faraday's law says that the voltage induced in a wire is proportional to the number of turns of a coil of wire, change in magnetic field, and the area of the coil. You can see that as you spin the motor, the magnetic field seen on the stator is changing, and a voltage is generated on the phase of the motor due to Faraday's law. This voltage can be in two shapes, either a sinusoidal or a trapezoidal waveform, depending on how the motor is designed. You can see that the back EMF voltage actually corresponds to a specific angle of the rotor, meaning that you can use the back EMF to determine the rotor's position. Here is the model of a motor with motor resistance, motor inductance, and the back EMF of each phase of the motor. If you do some rearranging of Faraday's law, you come up with the following equation for back EMF. In the formula, all the constants of the motor, like area of the coil and number of turns of the coil of wire, become a motor constant called KE. The change of magnetic field and the change in time variables can actually be simplified to the speed of the motor. The back EMF of each phase is offset 120 degrees from each other. This is why phi is within the sine term. This illustration shows that the faster the motor is spinning, the larger the back EMF the motor will produce. How do we detect the back EMF and therefore decide when to commutate? One way to do this, in conjunction with trapezoidal control, is during the commutation state where one phase is being tri-stated or high impedance. The back EMF of the undriven phase can be observed through what is referred to as a window. For example, when the motor is in this commutation step, the voltage on phase A can be read with an ADC to determine what the back EMF voltage of the phase is. This back EMF voltage can then be used to determine when to commutate the motor. Most algorithms use the zero crossing of the back EMF to determine where to commutate the motor. This zero crossing is when the back EMF crosses 0 volts. For sinusoidal motors, driving a motor with sinusoidal current means that there is not a phase to create the window used in the window method. So another way to determine the back EMF is by calculating it rather than directly measuring it. Here's a model for the motor with back EMF. If we connect a wire to the center tap of the motor, we get the following model of the single phase of the motor. From this, we can create an equation for the back EMF, and we can take the equation for back EMF with the rotor position earlier. When spinning a motor, we know the applied phase voltage, which is the supply voltage times the duty cycle. We also know the inductance of the motor, the resistance of the motor constant KE, and the speed of the motor. What we do not know is the back EMF voltage and the angle of the rotor and the current. We can solve this issue by adding a way to read the current of the phase. There are many ways we can do this. One way is by adding a shunt resistor. Using this shunt resistor in an ADC, the current of the phase can be read. This allows us to calculate the back EMF and the rotor position using the two equations on the bottom right. Before we talk about directly comparing sensorless and sensored control, let's go over the three application types of BLDC motors. The three different types of applications of motors are torque, speed, and position. Torque applications are applications where the desired result is to deliver a torque or a force to something. An example of this is a cordless drill. Because it does not matter what speed the motor is turning at, the desired result is to deliver enough torque to drive in a screw or a drill bit. Speed applications are applications where the motor is trying to achieve a speed and hold that speed. An example of this is any fan, because fans are usually set to a speed and maintain that speed. Position applications are applications where the motor is moving from a specific position to another specific position and holding that position. An example of this is a camera on a gimbal that is trying to point and hold the camera at a specific position. The three different motor application types all have different requirements and challenges. Torque applications demand zero or slow speed torque. An example of this is a drill that is screwing in a screw, and the screw hits something where the torque needed to drive in the screw is larger than the drill can deliver. So the motor will spin down to zero or slow speed, but the drill will still need to deliver torque to the screw. Speed applications require a motor to hold a specific speed, so the motor needs to withstand changes in torque without changing speeds. For example, a laptop fan is spinning at a constant rate and something blocks the air inlet to the fan. This will decrease the torque required to spin the motor. The motor controller has to decrease the current delivered to the fan to keep it at the same speed. Position applications require position tracking to absolutely know the motor position. They also require zero or slow speed torque, just like torque applications. An example is if you have a camera on a gimbal and something bumps into the camera. The motor needs to counteract the force applied by this bump without moving the motor. Now let's compare which control method is better for which application. Sensorless control has the advantage of being lower cost, easier to manufacture, and higher reliability than sensor control due to requiring no physical sensors. This means that often the trend is to use sensorless control if it can meet the application's requirements. Torque applications are typically required to use sensor control due to the zero or low speed torque requirement. A few simple torque stall applications can get away with sensorless techniques if the motor is not allowed to stall by gearing systems. Speed applications are good examples where sensorless control and sensorless algorithms have been designed to work well with. The requirement of withstanding changes in torques is dealt with in many different sensorless control algorithms. Position applications almost always require sensor control due to their precise position tracking and their zero to low speed torque requirements. There are many different ways to implement both sensored and sensorless control, and I have only covered a few of them in this video. Every motor application has different requirements, and each system designer will have to weigh the costs and benefits of each control scheme and each implementation method. Sensor control has been around for a long time, and there are many different implementations and algorithms that utilize this control scheme. Sensorless algorithms continue to develop so they can function in wider ranges of applications. Some of the challenges faced in implementing sensorless control may be solved in the future with more intelligent control algorithms. To find more motor drive technical resources and search products, visit ti.com/motordrives.